Okay, welcome back. You brave people come back and want to see the second part as well. Okay. Let's see how far we can get. So this becomes now interesting. So I think we are now at a point where we get to some really interesting questions. And I don't know if we really have to go through a lot of background. So we have now some overview of one of the basics. So this is one of the basic models that have been introduced, a fully integrated neural MT system that goes really from one language to another, completely through a neural network. So this is this one model that came out in 2014, I think. So where we have somehow a recurrent network that summarizes the information and then tries to unroll this. As you can see here in this link, this picture comes from a very nice little tutorial, a little nice description of the background of neural machine translation by Kyung-Jung Cho. And he, so if you want to go there, you can go. There's three parts and read about the explanations of all these different parts as well. So that's really some really nice reading. And I have at the end, I have some more links about some other types of information and documentation that you can look at if you want to get some more information. So just to say it once again, some of these images are just taken from some other sources. And it doesn't make sense to recreate pictures, which are quite nice explanations of these models. So I have a few more slides about the background of this, and then maybe we can go through this rather quickly. It's just to remind us of the entire setting of neural models here. And of course, if you have neural networks, artificial neural networks, they are inspired by some biological neurons that we try to model in some artificial way. So I don't want to spend too much time on this, but the idea is really that we want to have something that kind of is inspired by natural evolution that we have, that have developed our capacity in our brains. So that we have some neurons that get information from somewhere, some signals, maybe from some other neurons, process this in some way and produce some signals as output. So we have impulses that are carried over to some other places, and we have very complex networks of many of these neurons, and they try in together. They try to then collaborate and do pattern matching and do some kind of decisions. So it's really these complex networks that are in our brains that are really the inspiration for having these artificial networks. So there's a lot of similarities, as you can see in this little illustration. Also, this comes from some other sources, as you can see here. So there's, of course, a lot of good causes and background information that you can get from somewhere else. So if you get from that illustration of a biological neuron, then also a neuron inside of a neural network is similarly built into some unit, some kind of processing unit that can take a typical input or some input and process this in terms of a function, trying to build a function that produces output depending on the input elements. And what you typically have is that you have some weights that determine how the input is weighted, and then this function in here is an activation function that you have to choose, that you have to give, and this will take the arguments which are weighted by these weights that you have to learn and outputs some kind of signal. Typically a signal that is either positive or negative or on some scale. So what you have is you have this input vector, which is then typically one fixed size. You have fixed connections going into this neuron. You have this output scalar, which is the signal that it produces. You have some weights and some bias that makes some can shift the activation function around. And then you have an activation function which is fixed and defined. So the only task that you have to do is you have to find these weights that corresponds to a certain output that you want to generate. So I don't want to spend too much time on this, as I said, because this is just the background of these kind of neurons and neural networks, so that you have then some certain, you have a choice of different activation functions, so something that you have to choose. And basically they switch signals from negative input to positive input and produce some output given that input that you have given. There are certain properties that you have to take care of, because we want to also learn these weights. We have to make sure that the function is differentiable so that you can get these procedures where you can find optimal weights given some procedures of learning. You want to have this monotonic function, and then something that is really important is here that you want to have a function that is beyond just a linear mapping. And there's a good reason for that, because we want to combine different layers. And if you want to have, so if you have all these neurons, the thing that really makes it powerful is that you can stack them together in lots of different ways. So you can have some output that is combined with other outputs that gives you the input for other layers of the network. So here, of course, then the question is how you will make up this architecture or this kind of structure that you have to define. So this is the expert knowledge. You have to define these different parameters, like what kind of functions will be the activation function, what kind of network architecture is there, how is the connection between these different neurons. So this would be, for example, some kind of fully connected feed-forward network, and in many cases you would like to produce some output from some input, so you would have an input layer, and then some abstraction will be learned by the system having these hidden layers, which you haven't really defined by hand, but they will be, so these weights vectors that define the mapping from one to another will be learned by some learning procedure. So just to come back to this discussion about the recurrent networks. So here, in the case of natural languages, we have streams of information which are not bounded by anything. So we can produce longer sentences, shorter sentences. We want to have something that more dynamically can develop, which means that we need some kind of recursion. And this is done by some recursive networks, for example, where we have in the hidden layer, we have a definition that the input for some of these neurons will be taken from the output of the same one, so that you can really stack them together, but you have the same unit that really produces the output for the input for the next position, so that you can really just get dynamically more and more of these elements linked together. So here, for example, this would be some kind of character prediction model where you have input characters in some input layer. Here you can see again this one hot vector representation of characters. They will be mapped to these. They will be then input to these hidden layers. So if you see then this mapping is done using some weight matrix, and this is basically your embeddings, because now if you have a one hot representation and you multiply this by this matrix here, this basically means that you pick a column of that or row, let's see what is, depending on how you make this calculation, so you get a column or row of the matrix here, which is basically taking the embedding that represents that character, because each character has exactly one dimension here. So this is what the system does when going from here to there. It picks the word or the character embedding in that case, which will be one input part. And then let's take this one here. So this will be input to that function. Then another input comes from the previous step, and it puts all of these input signals together and produces some output, which will then be the input again for the next element, which takes then also the embedding from the next character. But it also outputs some kind of the signal for producing a target character. So from there you can then do some computation to get some probability value where you can choose the character that will be produced by the system. So again, you have here some weight matrix. So now the interesting thing is, of course, because you have a recurrent layer here, you only have to learn one weight matrix for the hidden layer, which will be reused in all these steps. So it will always be the same weight matrix. This is the recurrent part. It's always the same that you just copy. And this is would be then also one weight matrix that actually gives you all the word the character embeddings that you have. Exactly the same for this mapping here. So you can have arbitrary length with this, and this is exactly what we also need for MT. So just quickly saying something about nonlinearity. If you have now some kind of complex networks where we have different neurons working together, having nonlinearity makes really the system much more expressive. And one reason for having nonlinearity is also if you combine them, you have a very complex system that you can approximate all kinds of functions with that. If you would have linear functions and you combine them, then you stay within a linear system. So you don't really make the system more complex by stacking these things together, because the combinations will still be a linear function. So you don't get beyond the expressiveness of the network if you don't use any linear functions. So with having these kind of nonlinearity and network structures, you can see neural networks as some universal function approximator. Any kind of function can be approximated there, which makes them very powerful, of course, of having this mapping from some input to some output. So one risk is here. So if you go back to your machine learning classes, then of course you know that if you have a very high capacity that you can have in the model, then it tends to overfit very easily, because it can find some decision boundaries which are over complex. It really fits too well to the data. And that really also happens with the neural networks. And that's why a lot of these tricks have to be a lot of these techniques have to be used for regularizing the learning functions, so that you take care of overfitting issues by, for example, adding some noise or doing some other ways of regularizing the network, the learning function. Okay. So just very quickly about training those networks. I don't want to present like mathematical backgrounds of training procedures and so on. There's a lot of textbooks and a lot of information where you can look it up. Basic techniques that you can use here, you have some gradient descent that you apply here. So you try to find you have to differentiate the function, the objective function, and then you have to see how you can move into a direction that improves the objective function, for example, cross entropy or whatever you use for your objective function in the problem that you're trying to model. So that means that you have to have some labeled data, and in our case, the labeling is the translation. So of course, any kind of sequence to sequence problem will have that you maybe produce part of speech tech sequences, then this would be the labeling, but here we use the translation as our supervision. And then you can use these gradient descent techniques for finding the optimization for that function that the system really produces, the function approximation that the system tries to learn. So this is why you need this differentiable function also in these different neurons, that you can do these gradient descent techniques throughout the network. Because you have networks now, you have to use some techniques to go through the entire network, and this is this backpropagation procedure that you have to use. It's kind of a chain rule that you try to apply. You go forward through the entire network, and then you go backwards and compute gradients and try to adjust these parameters to optimize the function that you have seen. So this is the very expensive procedure of training, where you have to go through the entire network, the entire lengthy thing, and try to compute all these different steps that you have taken in the in the chain. So, because this is really expensive and a complex task, it requires certain hardware, and this is also the reason why this really became feasible first when the hardware technology really developed in such a way that those things can be done in a reasonable amount of time. And especially if you now do the computation, it's really essential that you use graphical processing units, so the GPUs, where you can do things in parallel, where you can use mini batches, meaning that you don't use just one example at a time and try to adjust, but instead you have a batch of examples that you can use simultaneously, and you can compute matrix operations efficiently on these parallel units here. So without GPUs, you wouldn't be able to train any of these NMT models that we have nowadays. And even on these GPUs, it will take days and weeks to have a reasonable system for a reasonable amount of data that you want to learn from. So thanks to the development of the gaming industry, we have now really these processing units that can help us training these interesting systems that learn and abstract from data sets in these complex networks. Also very quickly about one of the problems. So if you have long chains, recurrent networks, for example, where you go through a long sequence of information, then the problem is in this back propagation, it can be that these gradients kind of disappear because the information gets lost over the way. And the intuition here behind this is also that if you have, for example, if you listen to a signal, you kind of remember only the most recent ones. Most carefully, you listen to the most recent information, the other ones get lost. So there's also some information that gets lost, and this of course is a problem if you have long distance dependencies, some dependencies that you want to keep, information that you want to keep or you need to remember. There's a lot of work on how to improve that, and there's also essential developments that have been also done a long time ago, but now become really useful, and you all have probably heard about these, for example, these long short-term memory units. And this is exactly what tries to prevent these kind of vanishing information that you get. So instead of having just some procedure where you have a hidden unit that produces some output for the next step, you have a much more complex structure in here where you have certain gates that can control the flow of information and say that certain types of information will be kept more carefully and also given further to the next session, the next step. So there's many different kinds of implementations. The most common ones are, the most common one is probably these long short-term memory units. They seem to be very efficient in catching certain problems and having these gates that control the information flow in several weights. So you will have forget weights and all kinds of different structures in here. I would say that it's better to look up the explanations of long short-term memories somewhere else. It's not really the topic for here. But this is only to present that you can plug in any kind of memory unit inside of this recurrent part here to control the flow of information. So another one would be gated recurrent units, which is also something similar, slightly less complex structure internally. But you can think of having some little memory units that you really stuck together, you put together in a sequence. And they have different types of memories that they can use for giving information further to the next step. So this is really important also for NMT, where you need these kind of longer types of information that you want to keep. So now the interesting thing is that all of these elements are really implemented. It's really easy to get started by this. Because you have now also toolboxes and information, implementations of all of these networks and procedures that makes it easy to get started. So you don't even have to think about this, just saying that, well, I take my LSTM implementation out of the box in my favorite library that implements and provides that information. So something that we really have to take care of is of course how exactly do these networks, the architectures have to be built. We have seen one picture of some kind of architecture, so we have to consider, for example, the number of hidden layers that we want to have. And sometimes it's really not, there's no clear idea why would we have to, would like to have another hidden layer. because it's not exactly sure what would that add to the architecture, what kind of capacity do we need in our network to actually capture the information that we want to capture. So there's a lot of open questions, and we are already started discussing this, and usually you don't have a quick answer to that. What is the dimensionality of these units? What is the best memory unit that you want to use? What is the number of layers? Most of these cases you really try to fix empirically and see what works best. So it's more this practical solution, that engineering solution that we think of. We have to test and trial and error is quite often the strategy that has been used. One problem with neural models is that training procedures are so expensive and slow that just in brute force testing all kinds of settings is not really possible, because you would spend years for just testing. So you need some kind of intuition to see what would I need to test to see maybe a little benefit. But this is something that, let's say, even in these 2 years only, a lot of progress has been done in this way already, and this is quite impressive to see that without having the possibility to really carefully test and train these hyperparameters, you have seen that a lot of progress has been done in the field. So, other practical questions? Also, you have to talk about the learning procedures. For example, there's in these stochastic methods, you need some kind of learning rate. So how much do you want to update your weights, for example, in each step? How important is the signal that you give for every mini batch that you try to put in? So you have to also consider what is the mini batch size that is restricted by the size of your memory on the GPU, for example. Another thing is that because we have this kind of stochastic procedure, it's also important to see how do we initialize our network here. Do we just start by some random or uniform setup, or is it better to have some more sophisticated guess of the initialization? Another thing is that there is no clear determination, so you can just continue learning. You can always just continue learning with these networks. There's some convergence, but you can continue training on those data sets that you have, and it's sometimes not exactly clear what the stopping criterion would be. So you don't want to overfit too much for the data, for example. If you just go for convergence on the training data, maybe the system really overfits completely to the data set and it doesn't generalize. And that means that sometimes you want to have other stopping criteria, saying I want to stop early, or have another kind of development set where I have some kind of stopping criteria that I can look at that unseen data and see how much my current system tries to generalize for these other sets. So these are considerations that you have to look at. And related to overfitting is then of course the type of regularization that you want to use to avoid exactly that problem that you overfit to your training data. So there's a lot of these tricks and really important things, because they can have a quite huge effect on the performance of your system. And that maybe is the most complicated part to get started with this. The software itself is not such a big problem, the data is there, but all these kind of essential parameters and procedures are quite important to make some to make really the performance in the way that you want expected. So, just to give you some of these links or some information about where you can get started if you want to go look at software. And this is actually quite a confusing situation. Before, in the statistical MT world, it was quite easy because there was MOSES and maybe a few alternatives. But now we have a lot of frameworks that compete with each other. So now now it is really easy to get started, but you have the choice and you have to make a selection where to start and what kind of toolkit to go for. But on the other hand, it's of course also nice. You can go to your favorite implementation and see what suits your needs best and what kind of code really is the most accessible for me, for myself. The nice thing is also that all of these things are openly available, so you have all these libraries are actually open source, which is quite different to the situation before. So even now companies realize that they have real benefit by opening their source, because now suddenly there's a lot of people coming and giving feedback on these things. So they get, of course, a big push from the entire crowd of developers, like TensorFlow from Google, for example. By just opening it up, now people are using it, and the system, of course, develops. So they take advantage of all people trying to use that system. It's not only that they are nice to us, but it's, of course, also for their own benefits. You can see there's a lot of these other toolkits that came out in the same way. Torch, I think, is somehow backed up by Facebook, might be also MXNet. So sometimes I've lost control about these different implementations. Theano is probably the oldest well-known one, which has been opened but from academia, which is still used quite a lot. So where you have automatic differentiation in all of these sets here. You have implementations of sequence-to-sequence models. You have all kinds of different toolkits and visualization possibilities, which differ from implementation to implementation, but they have basic routines that are always the same. You have to manipulate matrices and these multi-way matrices, tensors, which you need for these calculations of these functions inside of neurons. You have this automatic differentiation that you need for the learning procedures, and you usually also have these routines to put it on a GPU. Typically, you have just a simple flag to say that now I train on a GPU, and it will do this parallelization, and the entire thing will just run on a GPU. There's a lot of smaller differences that we will not really talk about here, but I don't know, what is your favorite framework if you work with any of these? TensorFlow. So who's for TensorFlow? It seems like TensorFlow is the big winner. But who's using Theano? That seems okay. Theano is losing ground, because I think that was the most common one before TensorFlow was hitting hard. Who knows this one here? Dynet. Dynet comes out of academia. It's maybe also something that is now used quite a lot in DeepMind, because one of the developers went to DeepMind. IBM, I think, is also picking up Dynet.
By the way, how would you describe what is the future of Dynet? Do you think that it is good enough to be comparable with TensorFlow and Theano? Like, kind of bigger communities there, maybe, so it's kind of difficult to be compatible?
It's really a tough question, because I don't know either. So for me, it's also a very difficult question to see what is the future and what will be the most promising framework. And of course, you don't want to implement things in a framework that maybe is not backed up in the future. And I don't know. As we can see, TensorFlow get a lot of attention because Google is good in marketing itself. but I'm not really sure if this is really the way to go. You can see that other I think important is really that they're backed up by a large community. And it's a bit sad that Theano, which was really backed up by academic crowd, seems to lose ground. Because this, I think, is still not really this commercialized kind of background that you have there. Whereas most of the other systems somehow have a commercial partner that really pushed the development. And that's something that you see in our field more and more, that commercial interest really decide in what way to go. And of course TensorFlow has quite some power there. But I also know MXNet is something that seems to also grow. Does anyone know MXNet? So that I think Amazon is pushing that quite a lot. Is it Amazon and maybe Facebook as well? I'm not really sure. This is also in China, there's a lot of development. So this is Baidu, I think, is developing this paddle, but they might have even something else. One of my colleagues really likes Chainer, that's why I was putting it in up here, but I think no one knows that. So he's really pushing Chainer, but I'm not really sure what is the future of Chainer. I think it's South Korean, but I'm not exactly sure. Okay. So, but software is there, and this is really good. I mean, this is really an advantage for us now, because we don't really have to implement those things. And even more, there's not only these basic libraries that do the differentiation and the kind of basic routines are in there, but you have these high-level interfaces as well, which make it really easy to get up some network architectures and to run experiments. How many people use Keras? That seems to be a very popular high-level implementation that can, I think, can also, nice thing here is can abstract away from the underlying libraries because it can also use TensorFlow or Theano, maybe some other stuff. Blocks is something that has been developed also in academia. Lasagna, there's plenty of those. So you can really find many, many of these high-level interfaces to these more low-level libraries. This is also really an advantage, maybe a disadvantage, because we have to see what is the best way of getting started and what is the best way of using these implementations. So now something that really is interesting here for this tutorial, of course, there's also for NeuroMT, there's a lot of publicly available implementations. So now again, in the same way as it was with Moses, you could take this out of the box and just say, okay, I will give it a try. And you can take these toolkits. But here, again, there's a lot of different alternative implementations. They have different network structures. They have different backends. And you have to check what suits your needs best. And because this is also quite complicated for me to keep track of this, I try to keep a little wiki where I have at least some links of things that I see. If I see a new implementation of something, I try to put it up there. So if you want to look at these tools, it's not at all complete, but at least you can see different implementations if you look at that website here, and you can see also the backend that is behind it. So you can look at this and maybe can also help me to keep this up to date if you're interested. That there's another wiki somewhere else where they also have a list of these implementations, but you can check that out yourself. I think there's a link from this wiki as well. So that was a bit the practical things on implementations. Let's get back to NMT and the actual setup of systems that we can look at, because that, as I said before, this one network was just one example. We can go quickly back to this. So how does it look like? We had this idea that we have an encoder. Now, for simplicity, also just having this one hidden layer. We have somehow the word embeddings going in as input, and we have this recurrent structure here, which gives the information further from element to element. And in the end, we have an encoded sentence here. So this is the encoder tries to make an encoding from an entire sentence. And then this encoded sentence here enters the decoder and will be part of the input that goes to yet another recurrent network. So always the same kind of vector here goes into the hidden layer in the decoder, and the decoder produces through some softmax layer the actual output of words. So generates word by word from left to right and produces a sentence as the output, which comes originally from this encoded sentence here. So putting the picture together, it looks like this again, slightly different from before, a bit more simplified. So we have the essential thing is this input vector here that summarizes the entire information. So we have to rely on that encoder here, that all the information that we need for producing some translation is really included in this representation here. So we had some discussion about dimensionality already. So we have here a fixed size vector that has to fit for any kind of input that we see here. Let me see if I understand the question. So
we have this hidden representation and we want to feed it to the encoder. I can think of two pictures. So one picture would be to feed it as the input for each state, as shown here. Another one would be to say, okay, we have some hidden states for the decoder, let us concatenate them with this representation.
So that this would
just exactly the same problem?
So that this would only be the input for the first one. Is that what you mean? Yeah, that's what it's done here. So it concatenates. So it's always the same input that goes into all stages here, but it also produces some additional input that will be concatenated with that information. So somehow it takes the complete representation and the reduced one. So
and probably also some input like the prefix of the generated.
Yeah. So the previous word in that case here, only the previous word that is also input. So it's all concatenated as the input. But you can have lots of different structures. So I could also imagine that why not just taking this only as the initialization of the first. I don't know what will happen then. Probably it doesn't work because that seems like the first thing that you would try to say that if you take this and then the first unit will reduce, take away the information that you generate, and then you have something left over and go to the next.
So I have no clear picture like what is that picture really.
So I haven't tried that myself, so I can imagine that, well, let's take it as an exercise for you. You implement a system where you only take that vector here as an input and then don't concatenate it to each step here. Does that still work? I probably doesn't, because then this would be the model, like the architecture that will be presented in most of these papers, and I can imagine that there's a problem of the recurrency, that this somehow doesn't really memorize too well what is already taken away. It forgets things that it has generated already. So I think there's the same problem, that there's information lost somehow, and that probably doesn't work that well. But we will come back to some other architecture, because I can already tell you this is not going to work very well anyway. The picture that is also shown quite often is that if you look at this and you think of, well, we're computational linguists, we actually care about language, and then we say that we map this into one vector of numbers, that's not really satisfactory. And then there's this famous quote by Ray Mooney saying that, well, you cannot cram this meaning of a whole sentence into one fucking vector. And it's kind of true, because you seem that it's really this engineering point of view. We just take our network here and we'll just learn, you know, map things to a vector here and that will be fine. But this doesn't make sense if you're thinking of a linguist. This is not how we humans are. We just don't have this fixed sized memory here and say that any kind of input will be put into this box here and we can get the representation. And it does not work. It works surprisingly well, but it has its limits. And of course, you get this question directly. So does it really work for longer sentences? And it doesn't. So it's if you have here the number of words that you have in a sentence here, and you have a fixed size of your vector here, there's a certain capacity that you can learn. And you can see that it quickly drops the performance if you go to longer sentences. And this is quite common. So depending on the genre and what kind of things that you want to handle, you get longer sequences and you cannot really capture the whole thing into the same size vector. So there's something that is really not satisfactory. We can handle all these dynamic length input, but we cannot handle it well with that model. because it will still reduce, try to compress everything into just one same size vector. And that representation is not working well, but we have seen in the beginning that NMT seems to perform very well. And that's because the model that I've shown before is not the model that has been used in these recent campaigns. But instead, there's two important additions that have been added to these models. First of all, it's not really satisfactory that we only memorize the history before. So we can consider these hidden layers, these hidden nodes here, that they always summarize the information from before. So this will be the summarized information from the current token plus the information that we have from before. But it doesn't know anything about from the rest of the sentence. So there's nothing that really knows anything from later on. So this is not really a perfect representation of the contextual situation of that position. But if you look at these architectures, it's really easy to do exactly the same from the back to the front. So you can add another layer of a recurring network where you just encode things from the back to the front. So now you have, again, a hidden layer here where you summarize the information from the right-hand context. So you have now some vector here that includes the information from the right-hand side, and you have one that includes the information from the left-hand side, and both together give the information of that token inside of the context. So it's like the context window around it that will be represented by this thing here. So this is one extension that you can see. And you could, for example, then say that, in the end, you can decode maybe this part and this part together and put it into the decoder. But instead, I feel like a model. Instead, we can have yet another addition, which makes it really more powerful, is that instead of having just one of these encoded steps here that we sent into the decoder, we want to make use of all of these positions here. So we have vectors at each position that somehow summarize the information at that position plus some context before and after. We want to make use of all of that, these information steps to decode into the translations. And this is this famous attention mechanism that has been added. Yet another kind of network structure that you add to the system. They say that now I have another network that takes as the input the information from the decoder, from the hidden state. It's not really visualized here, but it then also looks at all these positions here and computes how important is that position for producing the output that I want to produce. So it learns how much attention to put onto certain regions of that sequence here. Yes?
For Europe, there is no outgoing arrows here. Is it not?
You mean here?
Yes. We don't use information.
This picture is not complete. It also doesn't have an initial vector. It has to have some initial vector here. So you need an initial vector, otherwise the function is not complete. But you have some kind of initialization that you put in here, and the same here. And the output is basically ignored because we don't take that into the decoder. It produces some output, but it's not really used. Instead we use, it is used. Take this back. The output is used to combine it with this attention model. So each output could be a weighted input to the decoder. The picture is really not good. Well, kind of this is the output. Yeah, so this is the output of the combined thing. So what I meant by this error here is that we concatenate the output of these neurons here. Okay? Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So but this picture is kind of simplified. But let's say so we have some other network that can learn weights that show how important it is to look at certain regions of the input sentence, which means that now the system is using not only the entire encoded sentence, the final thing, but it can decide where to look and where to get the information from. And it typically combines all of them to some degree, but it has very strict, very strong, quite often very strong predictions on where to look and to get the information to decode something on the other language side. So all of these parameters now again, to learn, for example, how that attention weight is calculated, will also be optimized according to the training data. So again, you have some kind of learning procedure that learns for specific sentences, for specific constructions, how to focus on the source side. So now this is really nice because then we have a dynamic length of sentences, but we have also we can use the entire information, and we can select the information from all of these different places. And you can see this really shows the how the information can be much more complex. You don't really rely on the entire encoding, but instead you say that this part and this part is now important for translating something. So this really was a huge benefit for integrating. So if you also somehow visualize that, so you would, the attention mechanism would compute some kind of weighted average over all these hidden states that we have here. So typically you try to, just also for explanation purposes, you try to have a softmax here again, so you're having some kind of probabilistic value that adds up to one, showing that it's really the expected, the weighted average of all of these vectors here that we try to get as an input for the hidden layer in the decoder here. So for each of these steps, now this attention layer or attention network learns for each position in the source some kind of weight, and this will be used for averaging over all these hidden information steps. So basically, if you run through this, it will just update these weights according to the input that it gets. And again, this attention mechanism is also something that you just learn from data. It's nothing that you have to define by hand. There's no expert knowledge that defines that here and there. These kind of constructions should be mapped together. Then, of course, the interesting question is, how well can it learn this kind of information? And it was surprisingly well how you can see how this really matches up with some more intuitive alignment that you would do between different regions. So now, going back to this, you can plot these probabilities also on some plot that looks almost similar to these word alignment matrices that we have seen before, where you mark the words that are aligned with each other. But instead, you just plot the probabilities that you get for the attentions. So according to the position that you're in the target sentence and these different probabilities. And if you plot that, you get for many sentences quite clear pictures on where the system is concentrating on. What is the focus of the system? And the really fascinating part of this is that this is purely learned from the data. So again, this is an unsupervised alignment learning that you have purely from the signal of translating sentences into other sentences. So this was, again, tried first for English-French. And you can see that most regions are very dark, meaning that there's almost no attention on that regions, whereas there's quite a clear picture on what regions are important for translating certain things. And it can capture reorderings like this. You can see that there is attention to some other places. And it's really a blurry picture, but it's surprisingly peaked to certain regions where you intuitively also think there's a really strong connection between those phrases and words. Okay. Also, other types of visualization can look like this. We just draw lines. And this looks like similar things that have been done for word alignment in the statistical empty world. But now, instead of deciding, well, also in the statistical empty, you would have fuzzy, f- fuzzy links in the end, but often you discretize them to just some word alignments that you really fix. But here you can see that there's kind of soft connections between words, and they explain quite well where the system is looking at to translate certain things. So once again, fascinating how just a data-driven technique can pick this up. And again, this is the success of NMT in the end, because now it can use much more information from the entire sequence and put it together into the decoded elements. Any comments about that? Can't click. So let's look what happens. So of course, this is still from the beginning when this was proposed. You could see that this really captures the problem that longer sentences are not really decoded well by the standard technique from before. So there was a problem that really degrades. But if you now use some kind of attention mechanism, then you can see that it stays stable even for longer sentences. This again is one experiment, so of course there needs to be more evaluations, and there's difference for different test sets. Still, for long sentences, the performance usually degrades. In this case, it's probably a bit over optimistic, but you can see that you can really catch up with the problem of longer sequences to also translate them well. So here are some different settings where they also had training data that were restricted to certain length, and you can see that, of course, this dotted line, if you train only on 30, the size of 30 tokens per sentence, then also then the performance degrades. But if you have also these longer sequences in training, then the system can catch up with these longer sentences and perform quite well. So this was that paper that introduced this attention mechanism. Now, if you work in other fields, then attention mechanisms now are all over the place. So if you work in parsing or any kind of other techniques that use deep learning, attention seems to be the thing that really is important for many different tasks. We can learn to get connections between different elements in a sequence. So, how am I doing with time? We do skip this maybe, because we talked about this already. There's challenges is the number of parameters. So we have a huge number of parameters that have to be optimized. And as you can see, we have, depending on dimensionality, these matrices really grow. And we have to fit parameters for all of these positions, for all of these matrices. So that's, of course, quite a difficult task to fit properly. Another thing that we can talk about more, and then that we will focus on more, is that also the restriction to vocabulary size. So typically, what you can handle with the current technology is something like 50,000 types, so vocabulary of 50,000 words, basically. And that is too restrictive to do something in MT. And we talked about overfitting, and let's skip that as well. So there's a lot of work that is done on regularization and how to avoid overfitting and how to look at convergence in training. Let me see. I'm considering to skip some of these parts, but let's look a little bit on decoding, how decoding works. So we said already that we do left to right decoding, and there's different, of course, also different possibilities of doing that decoding. Because now we just said, okay, we select some word here, but of course you can do certain different things. You can have a kind of greedy search, saying that you just, for example, take from the entire probability distribution that you get from your softmax layer in the end, you take the item with the highest probability. So that would be kind of very greedy way of doing that, and then you do this until you stop and get this stop symbol. I think more common is to do some kind of sampling-based approach, So that because you have now the entire distribution here, you don't want to only focus on the most likely one that you always pick, but instead you want to use the probabilities that you have in the entire distribution to sample a word from that position. So it's kind of similar to this greedy that you just pick one word, but you pick the word according to the probabilities that you have in the entire distribution, so that also other words have a chance to be selected. Which then is nice because you can extend that easily to a beam search, where you have this kind of greedy, well, this kind of sampling approach selection, but you repeat that selection and do it maybe 8 times, 10 times, so that you have at each position, you would have alternative things that you can sample from your distribution, and you keep a beam of hypothesis. So like in typical beam search, at each step you keep only the 10 best or the 10 hypotheses for the next step. So you can do this sampling for each step again, and then you keep only the k best hypothesis at each time step, and in this way you get a larger proportion of possible sequences that you can let compete with each other in the end. So in the end you can get a full probability of the entire sequence, and you select the one that is the most probable one, but you can also get these k best translations, which could be interesting to see what kind of alternative translations the system can produce. So this is not very strange to look at, so you build up some kind of tree structure. So this would be like step by step continuing to produce new things, so that you keep only a certain number, like three possibilities, and then you generate the next step and you always keep only three, and you get in the end sequences of these possibilities. Yes? Yeah. No, I see. But I don't have the answer. They are not applied, so I guess that they are impractical for some reasons. But I don't really know why exactly. I think the softmax is really expensive, which might be a reason for that. But I'm not really sure. So I haven't seen CRFs in the decoders for the systems I know, at least. Yeah, so that's, yeah, no, that's what I mean. The softmax is really expensive over large vocabularies, which probably makes it impractical. But I have to admit that I don't know exactly why if that is really the case. But I guess it's related to vocabulary. Yeah.
So have you ever tried to apply CRF on the top of decode phrase? Because in my opinion,
No, it's the same question. So you would have a globally optimal decision if you would have a CRF, but I think there's just practical reason that this doesn't work efficiently enough. I'm not exactly sure, but I think there's some problems to really efficiently get this done. It's not completely independent because you always take also the symbol that you output is also input to the next layer. So it's not completely independent of the produced symbols that you have. So network structure already says that you have a dependence on the previous word, for example. But and also of course the recurrent network makes this dependence over the entire chain. So the hidden layer always depends on the previous. It's not independent decisions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Where is that? Ah. What did I do? Help.
Yeah. that maybe help us to improve accuracy of the system?
Yeah, I think we are talking about the same problem here, that in beam search we would only have a few possibilities that we use from the whole distribution. Of course, the distribution is over the entire vocabulary, so it's really large. And I think that's why beam search is the solution to make this efficiently, and then CRFs maybe don't work because that's too large as a vocabulary. I wouldn't dare to really answer that, but I think there's really efficiency problems, even if you have efficient algorithms for CRFs, but this large vocabulary, I guess, prevents that. That's my answer. But, well, maybe there's an implementation, but definitely that's the case, because this, well, I think the decoding part is really not a good solution so far. It's kind of very greedily producing something from left to right, which also is maybe not the most the best way of proceeding. So there's lots of work to be done. So there's, of course, lots of developments that you can also be part of. So if you have other ideas of how to improve, for example, decoding, I think there's a lot of more things that can be improved here. A new trend is actually to go away from recurrent networks and rely completely on attention, and don't have the dependencies on recurrent networks to also make it easier to train. And that seems to be much more robust and quite an advantage. Also, convolutional networks are also used. So there's a lot of alternatives that we haven't really touched on yet. Okay, is there any other discussion about that? So decoding is still a problem, but surprisingly it works well. Yes?
Are there any alternatives to the stepwise decoding? Maybe it's something parallel, not word by word decoding, but something we went where we go from graph representation to increase the quality step by step, something like this, something we can do in parallel. Mm. Is there any papers or words devoted to something like this? Because, you know, step by step decoding is an iterative procedure and it is really slow. Maybe something like this.
So, there's probably more work than I'm aware of. Some work that I'm aware of is, for example, a simultaneous translation. They have this procedure that you don't want to wait until the entire source sentence is encoded and then you start decoding, but instead the system learns how long to wait until it starts decoding. And this is really nice, because this really goes into the direction that you can go, you can translate speech, spoken data. So that now the system has yet another mechanism that says, here's some kind of switch saying that, oh, I have enough information to now produce a chunk, and then it starts decoding, and then after that it starts decoding again after waiting for a certain time. So that goes a little bit in that direction, but it doesn't fix problems from before. But it could be, there could be a way of saying that later on when you listen again, you say that, I was wrong, I could go back. So that, I think there could be mechanisms that could also learn that. It could also simultaneously in the background try other alternatives and see that, oh, wait a minute, I translated wrong. So I think there's a lot of ideas that could be worked on, but I'm not exactly sure if there's any work on that. Most of things are sequential. We had one model where we wanted to use low resource scenarios where the reordering is not very well learned. Well, at least the sequential part, and then we try to generate words in the same order as the source language and then reorder them. So that would be an alternative also to output some kind of reordering operations instead of sequentially producing in the correct target language order. So there's plenty of possibilities here. Yes?
And you can actually parallel the translation of the sentences instead of making some parallelism within the sentence.
Yes, of course, but you know, that's the problem. That's why we use insert, for example, because if we make mistake, it's horrible. It's completely horrible, and there's some options like trying to make corrections. So, but it looks not as beautiful as it could be.
Mm. So I think the coding part really has a lot of potential for improvements. And so if you mention, for example, the sentence by sentence, I was working on a project for a long time now where we wanted to have discourse-wide translation. So you want to have something that is beyond isolated sentences. And I have some slides on that as well. And there's also work on where you can use the summarized information from the previous sentences and also take this as input for the next step, so that the system knows something about the previous context. But this is really hard to get some capture the essential information that you need for later translations. So this is much harder than you would think. It intuitively makes sense that you don't want to translate isolated sentences independent of the others. But it's really complicated to get that information to flow further. But yeah, well, let me see. But this idea about having maybe the system just in the background to generate more alternatives and so on and parallelize this kind of thing, there's lots of possible ideas how to improve that. So you would be, yeah, you can join that field and then just make your contribution here. And there might be, as I said, there might be some implementations in that direction already, which I don't know about. So there's really plenty of new things coming out all the time. Yeah, well, thanks for the... Something that there's a lot of tricks anyway that you have to use to get the performance up. And one trick is, for example, is the problem of training and learning. You learn just one kind of model with one setup of weights, but it's suboptimal because there's no optimal solution that you can get with these gradient descent, these stochastic learning algorithms. But instead, for example, to get away from these local optima or not even optima, some solutions that you get at the end of the training procedures, you can combine several runs of your learning algorithm. Just combine them and do these kind of ensembling. So you can combine several models to get information from different learning procedures or from different learning outcomes. This also reduces this overfitting, because overfitting, as I said before, is really a big problem. You fit to the data quite well, but if you ensemble over these different solutions, then overfitting is different and really reduces that problem. So there's different ways of doing this ensembling, and something that really is a very simple solution is that also you take, if you have worked with perceptrons before, empirically you can show that these average perceptrons work better than just letting it run through the entire procedure, but you average over all kinds of different time steps where the system has learned the model parameters. And the same you can also do with these models here, that you keep at each time step some model, and you use these models to actually average over all of them to get the final model that you use for decoding. And this again reduces overfitting problems, but also seems to basically for overfitting purposes it performs better. So this is this kind of checkpoint ensembling that I was talking about, that you can, during training, you just take snapshots. After some period of time, you always keep some model, and then you use these models to average over them, and you have this ensemble over parameters, and that typically works much better than one single model that you have at the end, because there can be a huge overfitting to some data sets. So this is really a cheap operation, because you can just dump your parameter space, your parameters on disk, and then in the end you can merge them together and just make this average. So the other methods to train independent models, you cannot average, because then the dimensions can really mean different things, and then you have to use some other kind of ensembling methods. So, but this kind of intermediate models really make no difference in decoding, because you have the same kind of decoding complexity that you have, because it's only one model. Okay. Few words about this vocabulary problem, because we have now just a fixed vocabulary size. So we really need that fixing, because otherwise we cannot make the computations at all. We have to fix the dimensionality of this one-hot encoding and how to get the embeddings and everything. So it's rather small. We have 50,000 words, for example, that we can do. But instead of doing words, we can do something else. And that really is the trend that we can see in neural MT, is that we go to other units than just the word level. So we have subword level models that we can train. And of course, the idea is there that if you have smaller units, you have a smaller vocabulary size, and you get also better frequencies or better evidences for these smaller units, basically. So you can do different kinds of subword level models. You can either use your favorite linguistically motivated morphological analyzer and see that you get some morpheme level translation, and also generating morphemes, for example. If you don't have any good linguistic tool that can really produce some segmentation or whatever you want to do, there's a lot of these unsupervised techniques that can be used, or also split things into smaller units. And there's a lot of work on getting morpheme boundaries just by unsupervised techniques and doing something like minimum description length based chunking. But something that really seems to be the standard now is coming from compression techniques, a technique called byte pair encoding, where you try to build chunks that frequently occur and in some way find these chunks that that are more frequent to split things into these chunks. And also a new trend is, of course, that you do purely character level, so you don't care even about chunks or morphemes, whatever, but you say that you have a sequence of characters instead of any other unit. An alternative to this is that if you have word-based models, you can also say that, okay, I cover all words that I have in my vocabulary, then there will be a lot of unknown words, and for these unknown words, I do something different. So you fall back, for example, to character sequences. So if you now recognize some word that you haven't seen in your vocabulary, then you go back to some other kind of model that produces information from the character sequences or whatever subword level you want to choose. And you can combine, of course, different kinds of levels between source and target. So let's look at this second one first. That's also something that we have implemented in our system. So that's proposed by Luong and Manning, Chris Manning, in 2016, where exactly this problem is addressed. So there's, at some point, we have now a word that we don't have in our vocabulary, which is cute. Because now we don't know what to do with this. The standard technique was to replace this with just a special symbol unknown, and it will just take this unknown embedding to go further in this sequence here. But this is really uninformed, because you don't know anything about the word. But instead, you go to a sequence model over characters, and again, you have some encoding of the character sequence. You combine everything together. It's almost like the entire thing for a sentence. You get some encoded vector for this character sequence, and you replace your word embedding with the final encoded information that you get from this character sequence. And then you just proceed with the same procedure as always. And the same is for the decoder side. If you try to decode, and now the system decides that, oh, at this point, it looks to me that here should be an unknown word, then you can go to yet another kind of and sequence where we can generate some kind of character level sequence instead of having a word generated. And then you concatenate these characters. So that was one idea. So that makes, of course, training and also decoding a bit more complex. Something that is more on a general basis is that you go to subword level. And now this slide is taken from Rico Sendrich, who was working quite a lot on this. So if you have, for example, a compounding language like German or Finnish or whatever, language that does a lot of concatenation, then you would like to split things into units. And you have different possibilities. Let's only focus on the last two ones here. So this would be no splitting, but there would be a word level model where you then somehow replace this unknown word with something that you can get from the input. But look at this. So here would be very simple. Say that instead of character level, we do bigrams of characters just to have a little bit more information. But it's just very, from a linguistic point, really stupid just to split it into bigrams. And then we have some other ideas, this byte pair encoding that tries to find chunks that are more frequent than just looking at the data. So let's look at this byte pair encoding, because that's kind of a standard technique that is applied. So this really comes from text compression. If you work on text compression, of course, more frequent units should be encoded with short codes. So you have to get the frequencies of different chunks. And here, it basically tries to look. First, it starts with just the characters. This is character sequences for all inputs that we have, so all words. So our vocabulary would be the individual characters. And this is just the word boundary character that we introduce. And then after counting, we can see that ES is quite frequent. So we can take the most frequent item to also enter our vocabulary. We can do the same for the next most frequent one, and this is EST. And then ESTW with the word boundary in the end is the next most frequent one. So we extend our vocabulary with larger chunks, basically finding the most frequent ones. And then if we want to then encode our texts, we can take our vocabulary and try to find the longest sequences that we can get from left to right and just split things into these vocabulary items that we have created by this BPE procedure here. So lowest becomes then low and est plus the word boundary marker. So using this technology here, quite simplistic, you can split up any text in a very unsupervised way into some chunks of highly frequent character sequences. And in that way, reduce the vocabulary, because now you split things into smaller units that don't increase the vocabulary size that much. So, and this has really a big effect. If you look at current methods, also if you remember this curve that I showed in the beginning, so BPE is something that is essentially applied in all systems or any kind of subword level model to capture these kind of open vocabulary problems. So here, this is our English-Finnish system that we try to train. And you can see that this really simple method, BPE, that is not very much informed, performs much better than most of the other things that we tried. So really, this just tries to split things according to frequency into some chunks. And this works much better than, for example, this hybrid mode, or not much better. It works better than this hybrid encoder mode that I explained before, so that we have word level and we back off to character level if necessary. But also surprisingly, it works better than using some real high coverage morphology for Finnish. So I thought, of course, that if we have some very linguistically informed way of splitting things into morphemes, we would expect a better performance, because we don't have these more or less arbitrary chunks. But instead, we have linguistically motivated ones. But we have seen that the performance is actually not that well, as we can see, at least in this evaluation. So if you do any kind of system, you can use Rico Senri's implementation of BPE, and then you basically get exactly what you need as the input and output for encoding and decoding for the training material. So here again, you can rely on existing implementations and just plug it in here, and it seems to be essential to use. So I have to somehow keep track of time. Let's see what else did I have. So I have quite a lot of other kind of extensions. Let's see if we get the most essential ones done here. So one essential one is getting more data. So because you need more data, and especially data in your domain that you're translating, it is really complicated to get parallel data where you can train on. And in the SMT world, it was really essential to have large monolingual data sets for getting the language models. Now, in the typical setup for NMT, there's no way of getting this. There's different ways of getting this in, but it's not an obvious way on how to get this into the training procedures. So you want to use somehow the monolingual data that you have for the target language to improve your system. And typically also that monolingual data can be in the correct domain, whereas your training data, which is parallel, can be quite out of domain. So WMT, for example, you translate quite a lot of news data, and then you train this on European Parliament proceedings. So of course that doesn't match. So in some way you want to get news data also into the network. And something that is really more like a hack that seems to work best is if you synthetically create training data from monolingual data. So you train a translation system from the target language to the source language, and you use that to translate your target language sentences into the source language. This is quite a bad translation, probably, or at least some kind of translation, but then you just assume that you can throw it into the training procedures. So you add that to the training data, and this makes it possible that you don't have to change anything in your procedures, but let the system run, and you get this good and perfectly produced target language data into the system. So now the system learns how to produce these target sentences, even though the input, so the source side, might be a bit noisy and crappy as some possibility. But because you don't see that as typical input for the decoding, so in test time, the system is probably not heard that much about this. Of course, it learns somehow wrong connections, and that's why you can also balance the amount of back translations that you use for training compared to the original data. But the interesting thing is that if you really do this, then you see this huge improvement here. So people get really excited about this. Maybe you don't get that excited, but you know, in our community, if you get an improvement of over one blur point, you're a superstar. And so this really makes that approach really something that is very important. And everyone uses this now, creating some kind of back translation synthetic data that you just throw in. This, just to compare, so this would be if you take monolingual data and you don't translate it at all and just put it in the same. And that really kind of, it also works, which is even a surprise here, but it doesn't really work well. It really confuses the system, but having some kind of translation that another system can produce is really helpful. And we did that for English-Finnish as well, and really boosts the performance a lot. So you get a lot of more data, especially for the target language, and that improves the language modeling part of the decoder. So you can see that for all possible languages, and then it's kind of a standard technique. And then combined with ensembling again, gives you nice improvements. Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, this is our finished system. And we see how you can also balance, for example, the amount of back-translated data. So it's a bit better if you do some sampling that corresponds to what you will train on, what you want to look at. So it really, you can see that you get a performance boost, which is really significant, something that you cannot get with any other interesting technique that you develop. By this kind of simplistic hack, you get much more out of the system than you would by improving any kind of architecture of the system. So this is quite important. let me skip this one here. So you can also reverse decoding, saying that I decode from right to left, and I can combine those things. So we have also done this. So this is somehow going further from simple left to right to also at least try the other direction and then combine these types of information. And this is also from Rico Senrich. So the Edinburgh system, you can see if you combine all these techniques, you really get these improvements that you need. So if you only do out of the box some simple NMT system, you will be below statistical MTE. But if you do all these additional techniques like BPE and ensembling and synthetic data and maybe this kind of left to right and right to left re-ranking, you will outperform the other state-of-the-art systems. And this seems to be true for all language pairs that have been tested here at least. So not all techniques have been tested for each language pair. So it's, don't expect out of the box state-of-the-art performance, you need to do some extra things. So, now the question is, are you still awake? Maybe I should stop. So there are some really nice other extensions. I quickly flip through this and you can say stop when you see something interesting. So there's lots of other extensions that are interesting. Combinations of phrase-based systems and neural systems. Always the idea that you want to combine. Here's kind of interesting that the system can pick up. If you pre-translate something with a phrase-based system, SMT system, and you use that for training, the system can learn that it can look at both the pre-translated data and the original input and learns to use both information to produce output. Unfortunately, this doesn't produce a lot of better translations because NMT is already so strong. You can also, now of course, then things come back like linguistic information. So you can also have factors that have part of speech information, maybe some syntactic information, and you use that as another type of input to the network. It's really nice. This is the additional context. So we try to just have more than just one sentence. You can see that there's slight improvements. Don't go through this, but interesting things can happen. Like, for example, you want to translate this word "ja," but now it also looks at the previous sentence and then it summarizes both things. So you can see that maybe a bit unexpected, maybe not really what you want, but you can see that it learns that in the context is something about hearing. So it asks, what do you want to hear instead of was denn? So what? But we can, I don't have time to talk about this too much. But you can see again in the attention patterns, so these are the attention patterns, that the system learns to also look beyond the sentence boundaries and getting some information from different places. Okay, this was pronouns, how pronouns can be improved in this way, because they can refer back to something that is beyond the sentence boundary. Okay, don't have time for this. Ho-ho! Yeah, this was more than I expected. Okay. So there's really nice things like multilingual translation. So you throw more than two languages into the system and you learn to translate between all of these languages simultaneously. So the same network takes care of many languages. Something that I also work on right now. So there's also this kind of Google paper that talks about this. You can also handle, in this way you can handle code switching data, translate that without any problem. Well, without any problem, wouldn't say, but. Okay. Okay. To get to some conclusions. So also you don't have to use only text. You can also translate images to text. So you probably have seen that the same model can be used to translate the signal that comes from images and produce a text. So this automatic captioning is basically machine translation in neural machine translation fashion. And you can see again that attention is really the important part. I'm almost there. So you can see that attention here points to the place in the picture. So now the word that has been produced here is people, and it really focuses on people. So it's quite amazing that the system can pick that up. And multimodal, where you integrate different modes in the input and produce some translation from image and text to translation. This is the one of simultaneous translation, where the system learns how long to listen until it produces some output. So also something that is really interesting. So We are back to the top, hopefully. So we just wait for the fall down. So there could be some AI winter coming later, but it looks really bright for the future, I would say. And if you really want to be part of this, there's a lot of possibilities to get started. There's these NMT implementations. There's more than that. You can get more information about tools and this website here. This is an alternative list. So there's a lot of information that you can get, a lot of implementations you can get. There's a lot of documentation. So look at these notes and tutorials. There's a new draft chapter by Philip Köhn coming out about NeuroMT. And there's this draft version is also online. Graham Newbig also has some nice tutorials on building with their system some strong NMT models. So that's it for me. Here's Helsinki and some people working in our group. Well, actually, Austin, well, he didn't die, but he's not there anymore. That's why he's in black and white. But we try also to be part of this development. So we want to build, for example, multilingual models. We have a lot of parallel data that we can work on, and we would like to improve our Finnish system as well. So with that, sorry for this quick thing in the end. I would like to thank you for coming and listening. And if you have any further questions, you can ask me in the lunch break or later, or you can contact me later if you want to.